serious questions. You're bullshit, my friend.
Who's paying me?
Hey,
back that shit up right now.
Where's the guy?
You never touch me again. Fire his finger on again.
Hey, I'd like to press assault charges. They're ignoring me.
They should ignore you, man.
We showed him the video of the guy assaulting me. I said I wanted to press assault charges. Excuse me! Excuse me!
I just stepped up to them to ask them what was going on, and they just walked away from me again. By law, they should have that man in handcuffs. We have the video evidence of him assaulting someone. I lodged a complaint. We have witnesses. I said I want him taken away for assault. Nothing was done. The police just ignored me and just walked away.
A source in America from the State Department and the CIA have confirmed that payments were made to a group in Libya that was associated with Osama bin Laden.
No, your inalienable rights come from God, and no one can force you to contract into the laws of England or the laws of Britain. You only have one allegiance, and that is to God and His chosen one. And I am, of course, that chosen one. I am the Lord Jesus Christ, and I now welcome you to the end times.
COINTEL PRO stands for Counterintelligence Program, primarily run by the FBI as a covert action program against domestic dissidents. The use of infiltration, psychological warfare, harassment through the legal system, and the use of extralegal force and violence began in the 1950s and is now a permanent feature of U.S. government. Targets included the civil rights movement, the anti-war movement, opposition political parties, and basically any progressive group in American society.
And it is our duty as loyal Americans to shut up.
My name is Charlotte Thompson-Nesserbate, and I served as senior policy advisor in the United States Department of Education under the Reagan administration, during which I had access to all of the most important documents for the restructuring of not only American education, but global education. And I'm also the author of The Deliberate Dumbing Down of America, which gets into all of this, gives the background of what I saw not only in the Department of Education, but as a local school board member. I was trained to identify the resistors. The resistors to the sex ed, drug ed, alcohol ed, suicide ed, death ed, those good, smart Americans who realize that anything that has education hanging off the end of it is probably not what they're looking for. I was trained to identify those good people and to go up against them and actually to go and try to get them to join us through the group process system, make them feel important, get them on a committee. And when that just blew my mind. I have to say, people often ask me, what is it that got you involved in education? Well, finding out what I saw at the local level certainly upset me. When I went and I saw that Americans were being trained to identify resistors, then I got pretty upset. And luckily, there was a big book that came with the in-service training called Innovations in Education, A Change Agent's Guide. And I was able to take that back home with me. Unbelievable examples of how to con the Christians and different people who are upset with what you're trying to do, how to bring them over to your side, case studies, true case studies of educators who had put programs in that normally, in a normal American town, nobody would want them. How did they manage to get them in? How did they con the people? And the other thing was, not only was I trained to identify the resistors, I was trained to go to the important people, high profile, highly thought of people in the community, with the Rotary, and Chamber of Commerce, Garden Club, you name it, the different groups in our towns. Go to them and convince them of the importance of these new programs like sex ed, drug ed, I just mentioned all of them. And get them on your side, because when you can get the leadership in a community to go along with it, then the newspaper comes in and says, a committee's been set up with the head of the Rotary and this and that, and they're all getting behind this task force to discuss whether we're going to have a new sex education program. And then when Mary Jones, who ordinarily would think, why would we want to have a sex education program when we don't have any problems with kids having sex or anything? So she might be concerned. She might be one of the resistors. She reads that her best friend, who's the head of the Garden Club, is on this committee, and she thinks, oh, well, hey, Mary Appleton is on that committee. She's heading it up. It must be okay. So I was taught really how to con the community. They always call everybody by the first name. You have to get very, affectionate with people, and you say, William, I'm so glad you've come to this meeting, and I understand your concerns about this program, because I've had other people, usually it's the really bright people in the community who have these concerns, and would you like to join our group? The original program was funded by what would subsequently become my office. It was funded by the Office of Research in the U.S. Office of Education, because it was funded early on, about the late 60s, still funded, by the way. And the money went to the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor to a professor by the name of Ronald Havelock. And he was the one that put together the whole training, the whole seminar, the book,